We're talking with C.G. Ware. She has written the most dangerous book I have read in a long time because it made me go to a storage room I have and say, why are you keeping this? Why are you keeping that? The book is called Right-Sizing Your Life, Simplifying Your Surroundings While Keeping What Matters Most, published by Springboard. Welcome, C.G. Ware.
Well, hello, Connie. It's been a while, and it's wonderful to see you.
But there are, what you say, the six F's to follow when you are in that point where you look at each other or even at yourself and say, I need a change.
Well, you know, this book came out, as you know, I'm a novelist by trade, but this came out of a big change in our life when my husband decided to quit his business and go into the dot-com frenzy, and we moved to San Francisco from Southern California, and we just took all of our stuff up there, and we put it in storage because there was no place to rent because of the dot-com thing. And suddenly, 3 years later, we started getting the bills for the storage, and we went to NorCal Storage and stood there while they brought five containers of stuff. They opened the, and I said, I don't remember what it is. I didn't need it. I've lived without it. And now what do we do?
Yeah.
And of course, the first thing that popped out of these five huge containers was this little rocking chair that I had petty pointed with my son.
I have to say, I read the book and I thought, that's your rosebud.
That's my rosebud. And I petty pointed this chair and this little rocking chair. And my husband says, well, we're not going to need this anymore. And he grabs it to put in the toss pile. And I started to cry. And what I realize is that an awful lot of Americans are going to go through this, where you've accumulated this for your 30 years of marriage or however long you've lived, and now your life has changed. And we were living in a compact city. We went from 4,000 square feet to 1,275 because we were city people, and we didn't need what we had accumulated. So what were we going to do with it? And that was the beginning of the book.
And but let me tell our friends, the six F's are financial, friends, flexibility, family, freedom, and the last one is what you do together.
Well, your flexibility and what you're deciding for your future.
Yeah.
Future. And those are the kind of watchwords about how you start making decisions.
Yeah.
And the other thing we realized is because our life had changed, it was time for a change. And giving up and letting go of things that you love but no longer have any use for is the hardest thing in the world.
Yeah.
My son is now 35. He doesn't need a little rocking chair.
Yeah.
So what's the proper use so that it doesn't end up in a landfill somewhere?
Yeah.
How do you turn back to the universe the things you've known and loved but have no use for? And so I started to think about everything like that.
Yeah. You know?
And what it really came down to is why at a certain point in your life, you only want the things you love and use. So how do you choose that? So then I said, okay, well, how do I choose it? Do I love it? Is it beautiful? Is it useful now? Is it sentimental? Is it valuable? And it really had to be two of those choices, of those six choices, to make the cut.
Yeah, let me tell our friends, too, in the audience, that chair does end up with somebody who's having a new baby. So it's like it's a generational gift.
Well, what I found out was that things that are family, it made you feel really good to find another member in the family. I had this sideboard that was 1,000 pounds. It was made in Missouri in 1840. It had come down to through the family. It was this huge, heavy, clawn ball feet, you know. Well, my son is in the movie business. He's very mobile. He has sort of a high-tech lifestyle. He wasn't the person for this. And I remembered my nephew who loved the, you know, had the grandfather's portrait in his house. And I called him up and I said, would you be interested in this? But you have to come get it. And that was the other thing. So I realized that there was a solution for every problem or every issue that came forward. We had a ton of old towels. And, you know, we had two bathrooms. We didn't have as many bathrooms.
Yeah.
What do you do with kind of ratty towels? Well, I realized, you know, the vet, the animal shelter, they need these towels. So the trick became kind of creative recycling.
Yeah.
And as I began to do that, I felt better and lighter. And instead of being this terrible, horrible thing of having to go through your storage, it became sort of a game. And in the end, I felt lighter. I felt exhilarated.
What did you do? Because obviously in my field, I have the books, I have the tapes. And it's sort of like sorting through the chaff and the wheat.
Well, I had exactly the same thing, because I don't know if you remember, but for a couple of years, I had a radio book show, and I got everything from the pineapple diet book to, you know, I had tons of it. The first cut, I called out what I knew I was never going to read, and I did give it to the library. Yeah. Not so much that it went on their shelves, but it was part of the Friends of the Library fundraising thing. And I got a tax deduction, which was great. The second was much harder. I had been collecting first editions of historical novels. And I kept thinking, wow, you know, I'm never going to read them again, but I could not give them up. Yeah. What I discovered is when you're trying to decide about these things, why, ask yourself, why do these mean something to me? Well, it meant something to me because my dad and I used to go see Errol Flynn movies together and all the swashbucklers and the Three Musketeers. My connection to these books was about my dad, but I couldn't hold on to them all. So I picked the two or three that I loved the most that had been signed, that, and I kind of made a shrine out of them, and they're in my house. I have them, and I passed the other ones on. I could have sold it on eBay. There's a thing called, I don't know if you've heard about this, it's called FreeCycle. And it's called FreeCycle.com. You put it on the online, they offer it to the world, people write you and say why they want it, you pick the person, they come get it, and they write you a thank you note.
Oh.
And it's the most liberating feeling that you know.
Well, that's great if you have time. But again, I like the chapter that says identify your favorite things and what do you need to be happy? I mean, you're not getting a mark from mother and daddy anymore when you set a table. How many glasses do you need? How much sterling silver do you need?
And you know, I said to myself, how many sets of dishes can I eat off at one time?
Yeah.
And we live, when we couldn't find a place to live, we actually bought a old dilapidated boat, and we lived on this boat. And what you learn about living on a boat, we did it for just a few months till we could finally find a place to live, is that you realize everything has a place. You don't need as much as you do. And what do you need?
Yeah.
So if you pick your favorite set of dishes, maybe two if you have room for it, you pick only the glasses that don't have nicks in them or that there's six of them. And as you begin to just cull and edit.
You talk about a couple in the book who ended up buying a boat in France. Yes.
These are actually friends of mine. There are a number of stories of actually people I knew before I started the book because I interviewed 60 people. These were people that had made a significant amount of money during the dot-com explosion. Then that ended. That big income wasn't there, and they'd bought the trophy house up on the hill, and they realized they'd have to work for the rest of their life. They were now in their late 50s to keep this house, and they said, we don't want to do this. So they sold the house, banked a fair amount of money for their retirement because they had nothing else, and they went back to a little cottage that they lived in when they were first married, 1,000 square feet, because they love France. So they went over, and for a less than a mobile home cost, they bought a 55-foot, perfectly outfitted barge. So right-sizing for them was a small house where they knew everybody and a place in France, which was not expensive, and they 5 months a year, they float down the canals of France. So they were very inventive about what right-sizing. And I realized, you know, don't downsize, right-size. For some people, like one couple, they had retired to a small cabin in Wyoming. Then they realized they had no place for their grandchildren. So right-sizing for them was to build a bunkhouse with six Murphy beds that came down. And when the kids were there, they put the beds down, they heated it. When the kids weren't there, the beds went up, they shut it off, and they didn't use it. So, yes, they expanded right-sizing, but it was right for them. So I realized it's depressing to say downsize.
Yeah.
But right-sizing means you're going to get it to fit you now.
And let's talk about the closet. The closet, I don't know about you, but I mean, I can find things that are still from high school days.
Oh, yeah. And things that I'm hoping I'll fit in someday.
Oh, yeah, the wishful thinking.
When I lose that 10 pounds. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think that we all have what I call our areas of shame. And people's closets are usually one of them. And what we really have to think about is, okay, have I worn it in 2 years? Does it fit my lifestyle now? When I used to be on television all the time, I had a ton of these kinds of outfits. Yeah. Well, now I'm home writing. I'm not doing that stuff as much anymore. That wardrobe, which is really beautiful, I don't need anymore.
Yeah.
So I gave it to Goodwill and felt suddenly I had room to buy a few of the things to fill in my wardrobe as I needed it now. So the closet, really, you have to pull it all out, say, okay, what percentage of my life do I get dressed up? Do I need ball gowns to go to award ceremonies anymore? No. So I don't have to keep all the things that don't have any meaning anymore.
Do you miss? What about the person who misses that life that they had and is holding on to memories and the hope that it will return?
Well, you know, I think there's this moment where, as my father said from his hospital bed, just remember, nobody gets out of here alive.
Yeah.
There is a point as you pass 50. I mean, right-sizing works for any age, but I think there's a moment 50-plus is that you realize your life is changing and that you do have to start letting go to make room for what's going to replace it. And I had to do that. You know, I ended my life, my career as a broadcaster for a while, and I had to make room to do other things. And I think when you start realizing that, you understand why it meant something to you, you pick the best of the best, then it becomes easier to let it go. And for instance, I took photographs of some of the dresses that I loved, but that I was not going to wear anymore.
It's a combination of when do you know it's time for a change, and what if one person doesn't want to change?
That's absolutely the hardest thing. And what I learned, and my husband was a little bit like that in certain areas. I mean, he had a tough time letting go of certain things. One of the things I learned is keep my side of the street clean. If I want to clean out my closet, I clean out my closet. Yeah. I don't use his not wanting to clean his closet out as an excuse for me to be stuck.
Yeah.
So that's one thing. The other thing is that you try to understand why are they digging in their heels. I had one, there's a story in the book where a guy had collected every single wooden boat magazine ever published for 25 years, and he had boxes and boxes. He would not give them up. They were moving to a much smaller place, and she called me and said, she was in tears. She said, he won't do a thing. I said, well, find out why. Why are these things, why are these magazines and boxes that he doesn't read important to him? Well, it turned out he had Crohn's disease, and he'd been in and out of hospitals and hadn't been able to go sailing for years. And these magazines, he admitted, were his hope that maybe someday he'd get better and he'd be able. So she realized, I don't have a right to take away his dream. So they were going where they had a two-car garage, and she said, your car parks on the street. We divide that space into two, and you can put in that space anything you want. And he put in the boxes of magazines he never read and gave up the other stuff he had to give up in order to fit into their new
place. There is a lovely last part of this. The past is the future, and the future is the past. Mm-hmm. And I would love to have you just read that last part with the family has passed on the house.
This is Judith Otteson and her husband, and they lived in this house, and they renovated it two different times. One time when their children went to college, they rented it for their new life, and now that they're older, they rented it for their old age. And they knew that someday this house was going to be sold to someone else. And so Judith, a tall, energetic, attractive woman, was dressed in trim slacks and a sage green sweater, the color of her eyes. She smiled a bit wistfully and recited what the message in the time capsule that she had put inside a wall that they were just finishing renovating, knowing this was the last house they were going to live in. And she put this time capsule in there. And here's what it said. To the future residents of this home, we made this house right for us and lived here in peace and love. We wish you the same. Judith Otteson and Lawrence Green.
Thank you. Will you autograph my book? We'll see you next time. Thank you very much.
Wonderful.